Hi, AT from CNC at Helm. I'd like to spend some time with LightBurn and just go over a few basic features. This isn't going to be a tutorial on how to use LightBurn. It's not going to go in depth into how to do drawings and trimming and that sort of thing. These are going to be a few features that I have found in LightBurn that are fairly basic features, but you may not know about. And so I just want to go through those real quickly. The first one we find underneath File, and it's called Show Notes. This is basically a freeform note area where you can type in any kind of information you want about a particular project. As we can see down here, we have the option to Show on File Open. This is very handy if you have some setup information about your project, or maybe some things you need to check, or in the case of doing some testing. I keep my notes about the testing in here, so I might put some feed rates and some power settings, talk about how that turned out. But you can type whatever you want right in here. Maybe you're doing a rotary roller project and you want to remind yourself to configure LightBurn for your rotary roller, something simple like that. I'm going to go ahead and turn on Show on File Open. Click OK. I don't have anything on this project, so I'll just do something simple. I'll just put a circle here, and that's all it'll be. And then I will save the project. I'll just go under File and Save. We'll start a new project, and then I will go open that test file that I just saved. See how this pops up? Any notes that I have in here, it reminds me of something that I need to do. This is a super easy feature to use. It's simple, and it's so powerful. It's something that you need to remember that's there. So let's keep that in mind when you're doing projects. Another basic feature we find over here in our Move tab, and it's the Fire button. By default, this is not turned on within LightBurn. So let's go see how we get that turned on. It's also set up to use 1% power. That way it comes on very, very dim. It's something you can see. I use it for focusing, checking coordinates, origins, and that sort of thing. If we go under our device settings and on the basic settings tab, we have enable laser fire button. You turn that on, this fire button will be available when you're using LightBurn. Another thing that we can set here is laser on when framing. Let's get that turned on. What that does is when we choose the option to do a frame, which simply outlines our project that we're about to burn, what it will do is automatically turn the laser on to this low power setting and show you exactly the maximum borders of where your burn's going to happen. In the past, what we've done is we've selected frame while holding down the shift key. That still works. So if you do not want to have the laser always on when you're doing a frame, leave this option off here. And when you click frame, just make sure to hold the shift key, and that will turn the laser on to this low power setting while it's doing the frame option. I want to talk briefly about our basic shape functions. If we click the rectangle and we just click and drag, we get a rectangle of whatever size we want. By holding the shift key, it forces this to be a regular rectangle or a square. And as I move, no matter how I move my mouse, it will always be a square as long as I'm holding the shift key. Another key that I can press is the control key. And that basically will force it to size from the center of the shape. By pressing shift and control at the same time, I get my square sizing from the center. The same thing with a circle. I can get an ellipse or an oval, or I can force it to be a circle by pressing the shift key, and now it'll always be a circle. Adding the control key sizes from the center, just the control key, lets me do ellipses but sizing from the center of the shape. The same with our polygon, the same kind of features. So those are just a couple handy keyboard shortcuts to help you with your shapes. One thing that we can also do with our shapes is, let's do a regular shape here. If we come over to the shape properties, and to make sure you have that under Windows, make sure that shape properties is turned on, and then you will have this extra tab. That allows us to change how many sides our polygon has. We can go as low as 3, and we can increase that up to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We can just keep going up and up and up, and it starts to look like a circle at some point, but it is a polygon. So if you need a pentagon, you can easily do that. If you don't like its orientation, there's a simple way to rotate that around that we'll talk about in a little bit. Here we can control certain things about our polygon, so just remember that this is an option to go in and make setting changes to your polygons. You will notice that my shapes are filled in on the screen. If we go to our cuts and our layers, you'll notice that fill is the mode for my current layer. If I switch this to line, then it simply shows these as lines. One thing that will happen by default in LightBurn is when you shift to fill or go to fill, these won't fill in by default. Again, there's a setting that you'll need to change. So up in Windows, if you come down here, normally it'll be wireframe mode. So even though we want to fill this, we don't see it, and that's a performance thing. If your computer is nice and zippy and fast, you can fill it all the time. The way that I used to do this was I would press my Alt key and P, which is the same as coming up here and clicking on preview. And then I could see everything filled in my preview mode. Once I found this feature to actually do the fill, I leave it set to that. My computer is plenty powerful enough to do this for the projects that I work on. So that's just a little tip. You can see everything filled in as you're drawing. It's kind of sweet. When you have multiple images or multiple objects, such as I have, it's convenient to sometimes group them together. I maybe have these set up a certain way, and this is the way I always want them. So what I'll do is I will select each one by holding the shift key. It'll let me do a multi-select. And then I come up here and click on group. What that does is it takes these objects that were selected. When I select any one of them, it gets them all, and they move as a group. When I do editing, it's editing them as a group. If I need them as individual objects again, maybe I want to move this pentagon over, get it rotated, I just select my object grouping and then come up and select ungroup. Now these are back to being their individual objects. We also have some mirroring and aligning options across here. These are also found underneath the arrangement tab. So you can get to them in either spot. An example of that, let me group all of this together again. And as a group, I can mirror this using the mirror vertically. So this will flip it over the horizontal axis. So that's handy to do. I can also mirror it across the vertical axis. We have other basic alignment functions up here as well. If we just hover over this, we have a left align to the edge. We can align to a center point. We can right align top, align to a horizontal, and align to the bottom. The way that this works is we select an object that we want to move. So let's say I want to move the oval to line up with the center of the square. I press shift, pick the square, and then I can do this horizontal center, and the ellipse or the oval will move up to be centered with this object. Maybe I want this pentagon centered between these two objects. I'll first select these two, group them back together, then I will select just my pentagon and then do shift select on this grouping, and then I can center them vertically and my pentagon moves over. So just keep in mind, the first thing that you pick is what's going to move, and the second thing you pick is what it's going to move or align to. There are other options up here for making items the same width, making them the same height. You can distribute things evenly. So if you have a bunch of things, you want them evenly spaced, you can do that as well. So there's quite a few powerful functions up there. You can play around with these. these shapes really don't make much sense to do the aligning that I'm trying to do with them. That's what these functions are for. We also have these little corner reference icons up here, and what that lets us do is we can take an object or a group of objects. Let's say we have this whole thing grouped together. What it would allow us to do is put this down into the lower left-hand corner, the upper right-hand corner, any one of our corners. We just click, and that puts that whole thing into one of the corners. I typically put stuff in the lower left, as that's where my origin is. So several features, play around with them and get used to what they do. Other features we have, as in most programs, if you press the control key and use your scroll wheel on the mouse, you can zoom in and out of your project. If you press the scroll wheel and then move your mouse, you can do a pan. So once you're zoomed in, you can then move around real easily just by pressing that center mouse wheel and then moving your mouse around. And then again, using the control key to zoom in and out. To reset this back to full screen, I'll just come up here and click this first magnifying glass that zooms it to full screen. If I have any objects selected, let me ungroup this real quick. If I have a single object selected and I press this outlined icon, it will zoom in to the selected object, which comes in very handy when you're doing editing. If you have nothing selected and you press this, it will zoom in to all of the objects that you have on the screen. If we select a single object or even a group of objects, we have its position presented up here. And by altering these values, either with the up and down arrows or by keying a value in, we can control where our object is on the screen. We also have the option to change its size. So if we want a specific size for this square, maybe we want it to be 100 millimeters. I simply type 100 millimeters in. This lock is selected, which means my aspect ratio is locked. So as I change the width, the height will change as well. If I needed to change this object into a rectangle, I can unlock its aspect ratio and I could change its height to be 150. It will resize based on this coordinate system. Right now it's set to the lower left, so if I hit the resize here, I hit enter, it's going to resize from the lower left corner. If I wanted to do that resize from the center, I simply select the center and it resizes from there. Okay, now let me give that select first. There we go. And then now 150. There. And it resizes from the center. We can also change the size as a percentage. If I wanted it to be 20% bigger, I just type in 120%. I will relock my aspect and it's now 120% bigger. And to undo any change, just like any Windows program, you can just press Control Z. And if you do Control Shift Z, it'll redo. So those are just keyboard shortcuts. You can find that underneath your edit menu. You have the undo and redo options, Control Z and Control Shift Z. I'd mentioned earlier that we might want to have this pentagon rotated. One way to do that, again, rotating about which point, we can either do any one of the corners or the middle of the sides or the center of our object, and we can key in a mount into here and it'll rotate. So if I want to rotate it 15 degrees, it's rotated 15 degrees. Many times what we want to do is rotate an object 90 degrees or 180 degrees. By pressing the period, it will rotate clockwise 90 degrees. And by pressing the comma, it will rotate counterclockwise by 90 degrees. So this comes in very handy if you need an object rotated 180 degrees. Just simply select the object, press period twice, and it's rotated 180 degrees. The last thing I'd like to talk about is text. It's a simple thing to do, just like any paint program. You click on the text icon, you choose the font that you want to have. You can be bold, italics, force uppercase. We can set the height. In my case, I'm set to millimeters. And we can set the horizontal spacing and the vertical spacing of the characters. And we can set the alignment. Do we want to align middle? Do we want to align left or right? And we can do the same with our Y. We can align top, middle, and bottom. And those come in real handy for just doing simple text. Many times I will have it go off the middle. I'll say, yeah, I want my text about here, and type in my text. I have that there. If it's too small, I can increase the size. If it's too big, I can decrease the size. If I know exactly the size I want it to be 10.25 millimeters, I can key that in. It works out really simple, just how you'd expect it to. Welded comes in if you're using a font where the letters might run into each other or overlap. If we were to change our horizontal spacing to make this negative, you can see how this starts to encroach the X onto the T. And if we do a preview, we'll see that those have gotten welded together. If we didn't have that feature on, so if we turned our weld off, then we end up with that funky little negative space. And if we go into preview and we zoom in on that, you can see that we now have negative space here because of those two objects overlapping each other. So typically, you want to have that weld on, and it does a nice job of making the text look professional. Those are just a few simple things that I wanted to point out within LightBurn that can save you a ton of time and make things easy to do. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Remember to give it a thumbs up. And if you like the content of our channel, please think about subscribing. That helps us out with the YouTube analytics. Pushes us up towards the top. We get more views. Everybody's happy. Anyway, enjoy doing your CNC at home projects. And if you use LightBurn, have fun playing around with that as well.